In the early 1800s, less than 5% of the global population lived in urban areas. Today, the number is 54%, and according to the United Nations, the number will rise to 60% by 2030. Almost 90% of the increase in urban residents will be in Asia and Africa. A large proportion of the global disease burden, including not least non-communicable diseases, is linked to urban life and the way we manage and build cities. Today, physical inactivity and obesity is widespread. Similarly, cardiovascular and pulmonary diseases are linked with urban air pollution. Some forms of cancer are associated with household consumption patterns, particularly prevalent in urban environments. Stressors of urban life, such as, for example, noise, may also impact upon mental health. Differences in demographic profiles and family structure between rural and urban settings will greatly influence the prevalence of particular health challenges in the given context. For example, in many countries, the cities represent a younger population and with a greater proportion of people living alone. This may influence the sense of isolation and loneliness among urban inhabitants. There are, as you can see, many challenges in terms of health and illness, and maybe that's why the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, the so-called SDGs, have dedicated Goal 11 to urban development. Make cities inclusive, safe, resilient, and sustainable sounds the mission statement in the SDGs. Urban development is a complex affair involving many sectors, but for the sake of human health and quality of life, it's crucial to understand the multifaceted and intercorrelated factors driving disease and health in urban settings. One of the most significant factors in urban development globally is the rapid urbanization, resulting from rural to urban migration and general population increase. The growth has outpaced the construction of adequate and affordable housing in many countries around the world. The UN Statistics Division estimates that in 2018, over 1 billion people were living in slums or informal settlements in which diarrheal diseases, malnutrition, tuberculosis, and other infectious diseases is much more common compared with wealthy neighborhoods. Poor urban indoor and outdoor air quality has also been documented as one of the most important risk factors for ill health globally, resulting in massive burden of disease in all parts of the world, notably through cardiovascular and respiratory diseases. The effect of poor air quality on mental health conditions are less well studied, but there are increasing indications that the link between air pollution and poor mental health is also real. The air quality is greatly influenced by the urban transport systems and the way cities are being planned. For example, in many North American cities with clear physical separation of residential areas from most other functions, the dependency on cars for daily commute influences local air quality. On the contrary, a city with a well-functioning public transport system may reduce dependency on cars and less polluting environments. Also less stressful for commuters and better accommodating transport needs, irrespective of socioeconomic status, age, and most possibly physical disabilities. Another characteristic feature from cities is noise. Noise levels may be a particular problem in urban areas with a negative health impact, resulting in sleep disturbance and increased stress levels. Noise pollution derives from many different sources, not just traffic, but also, for example, adjacent homes and construction work. The design of urban public space play a significant role in the physical and mental health of the urban population. Opportunities for sports, walking, biking, playing, and recreational activities facilitate physical activity. Likewise, the overall greenness of a person's neighborhood is associated with mental health. An example of how urban space can result in improved well-being is described in a study from Manchester, UK, undertaken by the University of Cambridge. The study found that small-scale, low-cost urban design interventions improve quality of local public space with positive impacts on livability and two forms of behavior related to well-being. The researchers termed these well-being indicators taking notice and connecting with others. Some of the findings showed that street trees, urban gardens, parks, in addition to walkable space and playgrounds, stimulate a greater level of socializing or may present as a quiet place beneficial for mental well-being. Good mental health is supported by positive social interaction and feeling of community facilitated by deliberate urban design features. The level of crime, as well as drug and alcohol use, has a huge impact too. Communities in poorer and socially challenged neighborhoods may feel marginalized and harbor higher levels of frustration and hopelessness that may lead to feelings of lack of safety. Personal security in an urban area may also influence urban life and how populations are moving about the city. Back in 2016, the Gehl Institute was hired by the New York City Mayor's Office to study issues of design and safety in a public housing development in Brooklyn. Gehl's came forward with a methodological-based approach for human-centered design framework for crime prevention through environmental design strategies, which can both enhance public life and tackle issues of public safety. In many large urban centers around the world, disparity in health will be influenced by social and environmental factors. These include quality of education, access to health services, coverage of sanitation, waste management, and domestic water supply. Urban environments diverge not only across cities located in different parts of the globe, but also across a particular city. For example, a city may include a suburban sprawl with planned infrastructure, single-family homes and small businesses, and at the same time a city center full of high-rise buildings with expensive apartments, shopping arcades and financial centers. But the same city may also include informal, very densely poor settlements with no centrally managed infrastructure and no available services. The retail sector, especially food outlets in urban areas, may determine what products are being promoted and available to the community. This may be a very important factor in influencing the levels of non-communicable diseases in a given area. An urban agriculture movement, although in its infancy, has sprung up in many cities around the world. Such initiatives include urban farming, markets connecting consumers with local fresh producers, from rooftops or community gardens. In the future, such initiatives may ease the access to broader community for fresh products. In other places, not least around large cities in low and middle income countries, peri-urban horticultural plots supply a significant proportion of fresh products within a short distance of city centers. As well documented in cities across Europe and North America, the process of gentrification is also changing cities. In this process, the urban areas is transformed in character, following the influx of new groups, often more well-off residents and businesses. Such processes may result in further marginalization of the long-standing residents unless policies and investments are in place to steer the development in a more equal, beneficial direction. the impact may be particularly negative on the elderly residents who find themselves priced out of the area where they have lived most of their lives. While recording this lecture, we are in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic. Pandemics such as yellow fever, cholera, smallpox, tuberculosis, polio, the Spanish flu, and many other pandemics have influenced the way we live and have developed cities over the past centuries. In all its sadness and disaster, pandemics may also influence the development of urban environments in the future. In the past, we have seen greater spacing between houses, wider boulevards, sewage system, waste management, indoor plumbing, allocation of areas for parks, set housing standards, just to mention a few resulting from past pandemics. We can only guess in what ways the current COVID-19 pandemic will influence our cities. Healthy living in urban areas depend upon the capacity of planners to adequately analyze and respond to the complex challenges of the 21st century. Clearly, future planners and health promoters in towns and cities around the world will require a workforce able to understand and employ integrated interdisciplinary approaches.